Well, good afternoon. Welcome students, colleagues, distinguished guests, and panelists to the UCROP Auditorium of the Robbins School of Business at the University of Richmond. And thank you to everyone tuning in through live stream. Today we have the incredible opportunity to welcome Ambassador Nina Hachigian, the United States' newly appointed and first ever special representative for subnational diplomacy. The University of Richmond is honored to host Ambassador Hachigian for her first in-person appearance since her appointment, and to share this historic moment in international diplomacy with our campus community and representatives from throughout the region. It is also a privilege for me, as in addition to serving as Executive Vice President and Provost at the University of Richmond, I'm a professor of political science and I specialize in international affairs. And as Provost, I'm thrilled this panel is doing this because it mirrors something we're trying to do here at the University of Richmond, which is connecting the global and the local. We have an amazing program and civic engagement for our students to engage the city. We have incredible study abroad programs, which large numbers of our students take part in. And we're trying to connect those two to give students a better understanding that actually what they're seeing when they go abroad are the issues that challenges their local community. And in addition, if you're working on programs here locally, there's a lot to understand and learn from by looking at international examples. And of course, we know our economies and societies cross borders. They don't respect them. So today we're here to learn more about the role of subnational diplomacy in international relations, the new role of special representative for subnational diplomacy, and how Ambassador Hachigian will serve our country in this new role. I'm pleased to introduce today's panelists. Ambassador Nina Hachigian is the first U.S. Special Representative for Subnational Diplomacy, and in that position, she will lead engagement with local elected officials and communities, both in the United States and abroad. Before joining the department, she served as the first Deputy Mayor for International Affairs for the City of Los Angeles. In that role, Ambassador Hachigian attracted international businesses and nonprofits to Los Angeles, began preparations for the city's 2028 Olympic and Paralympic Games, hosted the Summit of the Americas, founded the first global gender equity city network, Change, and started a program for underserved community college students to study overseas for the first time. Ambassador Hachigian previously served as the second U.S. ambassador to the Association of Southeast Asian Nations during the Obama administration. In her tenure, the U.S. held the first Leaders Summit in the U.S., launched a presidential initiative on economic cooperation, and established the Women's Leadership Academy. For her outstanding service, Ambassador Hachigian was awarded the State Department's Superior Honor Award. Ambassador Hachigian has also served as a senior fellow and a senior vice president at the Center for American Progress, director of the RAND Center for Asia-Pacific Policy, and staff of the National Security Council in the Clinton White House. She is a founder of Women Ambassadors Serving America and of the Leadership Council for Women in National Security. Welcome, Ambassador Hachigian. We look forward to hearing more from you shortly. I want to welcome back to the University of Richmond campus, City of Richmond Mayor LeVar Stoney. Mayor Stoney is currently serving his second term as the 80th mayor of the City of Richmond and is the youngest person to hold the office. Mayor Stoney is an advisory board member of the U.S. Conference of Mayors, where he chairs the Children, Health, and Human Services Committee. Mayor Stoney believes that government can play a powerful role as a creator of opportunity and has made investing in children and families his top priority. During his term, he has made the largest individual budget investment in public education of any mayor in a generation and prioritized the creation and preservation of quality, affordable housing, public works, infrastructure, transportation, and jobs. Thank you for joining us today, Mayor Stoney. Woo! We are so thankful that President Jenna Benyehuda is here with us. Benyehuda is the president and CEO of the Truman Center for National Policy and Truman National Security Projects, organizations that are dedicated to offering timely, innovative, and principled national security solutions. She earned multiple superior and meritorious honor awards during her 12 years at the State Department in a range of intelligence and policy roles, including senior military advisor to U.S. Northern Command, U.S. Southern Command, and U.S. Special Operations Command. A longtime advocate for gender equity and national security, she is the founder of the Women's Foreign Policy Network, and she serves on the advisory boards of the Leadership Council for Women in National Security, the Partnership for Public Service, and GlobeSec. In 2022, President Biden appointed her to the Air Force Academy Board of Visitors. Thank you, President Benyehuda, for being here today.
Thank you.
So I'm going to start today by asking panelists questions before turning to you, the audience, for your questions. So this is the primer for, you know, about 25, 30 minutes I'm going to turn to you. So please get your questions ready. Let me start off with Ambassador Hachigian. It is wonderful to have representatives from the Department of State to our campus again, and congratulations to you on your new appointment. I'm guessing what is first on many of the audience minds is, what is subnational diplomacy?
That is an excellent question. Before I answer it, though, let me just thank you, Provost Legro, and everybody here who's made this event possible. Thank you for the generous and lengthy introduction and invitation to be with you. And to join these two incredible leaders on this panel is really an honor. I've just met Mayor Stoney. I think he will become a friend. Jenna's been a longtime friend and co-collaborator. And I'm thrilled to discuss this topic because I think it's actually quite important to our foreign policy. So basically what it means is international engagement by government entities that are within a nation. So it is what Mayor Stoney does with his counterparts overseas, or what a governor might do with a counterpart overseas, or what either of them might do with the State Department, or how they, you know, interact in networks around specific issues. And in LA, when I was, you know, deputy mayor, we, for example, signed an agreement with the country of Chile, so that we could both talk about our water scarcity problems and how we were solving them. And so we decided to have an agreement that we would, you know, trade experts and so on. And what's great about this new position, and I'm like, you know, still I think in my first month on the job, is that it shows the Biden administration sort of recognizing that this is an important facet of our foreign policy, and especially for the Biden administration's vision for a foreign policy for the middle class. I think that, you know, country-to-country relations and, you know, groups of country relations like NATO, they'll still be the kind of meat and potatoes of what the State Department does, but this will be, you know, an increasing angle, I hope.
Terrific. So what will you be doing? It's daunting to think about it, right? I mean, if there's, you know, whatever, 146 nations, and but there's, yeah, there's more cities and states than that.
So, yeah. Well, I will be prioritizing. That's in short, that I think is going to be the real challenge of this job. But I'll describe kind of these three broad lanes that we see our work falling into. And again, this is early days, so this could change. But the first priority is to bring the benefits of our foreign policy to the local level. And I'm thinking about that in sort of two ways. There could be many things, but foreign direct investment would be one. So a foreign company wants to set up a, you know, manufacturing facility or a retail location, create jobs in a community, that's the first I'm gonna look at. And the second is opportunities for young people. The State Department has a number of internships and exchange programs that I think are not, could be more, aware. People could be more aware of them than they are currently. So that's the second So then the second kind of big remit is to encourage our cities and states to do more on the international stage. You know, we're not going to, you know, we can only encourage and support and maybe over time even bring some resources in the form of people who can help. But the rest of the world is quite engaged. Their cities are quite engaged internationally with each other. You know, learning through different networks about climate change and what works, and or gender equity and what works and what the challenges are. But America has been a little bit, for whatever reason, slower to the game. I think we were talking earlier at lunch, it might be just that we're such a big country that, you know, Mayor Stoney and others can get as many ideas as they need within the country. And so they don't, you know, necessarily have to look to the outside. But I think, you know, good ideas come from everywhere. And as well as, you know, all kinds of other connections. So that's the second piece. And then the third is just helping the State Department consider subnational diplomacy as a piece of what our diplomats do. So, for example, you know, you might get some resistance at a national level on a certain policy, but you might find a local leader who really wants to do a program on climate or a program on democracy or on inclusive investing or something. So that's just, there may be cases in which that it will help our foreign policy, on the biggest scale. So that, those are sort of the lanes that I see us working in.
So just to follow up on the kind of, late to the game, I mean, it's a two-sided question. Why is this important to the Department of State? And if it is important, why now and not earlier?
Right. I mean, I think the why not earlier, I'm not sure I know the answer to that, except for part of the reason, maybe, actually, I don't even really know, but I'm guessing that part of the reason the position was created is there was some demand in the United States for it to be created. Mm. Now, I've just been talking to Mayor Stoney. He actually has lots of international connections, and so it could be that this has all been happening, but kind of below the radar. But in any case, we hope to amplify it. From the State Department point of view, I think, being able to, as I say, like connect the benefits of our foreign policy to the local level is something that they really want to do now. I think transnational challenges have also brought this issue to the fore because it is mayors that are dealing with COVID and they're dealing with, you know, huge disastrous weather events and they're, you know, dealing with cyber attacks. And it, you know, these are all these transnational global challenges but they affect people in places. And so learning from mayors and governors about how they're coping with these challenges and what they're seeing, I mean, we really want to bring their views into the creation of our foreign policy on, you know, on these sort of tough challenges. The other opportunity I see is that our cities and our states have a lot of what they call soft power. So, you know, global reputations, and I think we've not, as far as I know, as a country, kind of tried to think about using that. Mm. You know, if there's alignment between the leaders and the State Department on trying to do something together, I think that's another piece of it. We also really want to recruit a team of folks at the State Department who reflect the diversity of the United States, and it's really local leaders who know how to inform those communities about the opportunities that there may be. And then I'll just say, you know, finally, that what I've noticed as a diplomat is that when there are ties below the national level, between people to people or university to university or city to city or what have you, that really serves as kind of a ballast for national relationships, and then we're able to weather, you know, difficult times if we have, you know, allies and friends and partners lashed up at the local level too. And why people should care about it is that, you know, at the biggest, broadest level, like, our diplomats are out there, you know, doing their best to create peace and stability and all that. But in terms of my job, you know, trying to bring these benefits of good jobs and investment, you know, that could be new nonstop flights. It could be, you know, being able to host an international gathering. It could be, you know, like I said earlier, someone setting up, you know, a facility of some kind. And that, in addition to engaging young people more in State Department programming, I think is why. And there'll be a lot of other things we learn along the way, too, I think. But that's our going-in proposition.
That's great. So, Mayor Stoney, as the city's elected leader, how do you see Richmond's international engagement impacting the city, the local community, businesses, even students here on campus?
Well, I think first, Dr. Legro, let me say thank you to you and thank you to the University of Richmond for hosting this discussion. It's always great when we can bring people like the ambassador into town to talk a little bit about not only the city of Richmond, but also how we think about ourselves in the whole global conversation. It was maybe a few months ago that I received a call from Mr. Ricchetti that the State Department wants to talk to you, Mayor. And I was like, why would the State Department want to talk to me? Have we done something? Did something happen? Is there an issue? But he started to talk about when President Biden became president, took control of the office, that they wanted to strengthen these relationships with localities. And I said, that sounds like a great idea, but you know, sometimes we have to be a part of the show me gang, right? Like it's a show me that you really want to do this. And this is right here a great demonstration of what the State Department wants to do with cities all across the country. I, as mayor here in Richmond, can say that over the course of the last decade, we've seen tremendous amount of growth. Population growth, economic growth, and cultural growth. And one of the main reasons for that cultural growth stems from our people. If you look at the fact that we have sister city relationships across the country, that across the world that were here before I was mayor, but we've tried our best to continue to cultivate those relationships. We have 6 cities over 3 continents. I'm very surprised by the amount of times that ambassadors come to town and they want to sit down with the mayor. Being a former a member of a state administration, I saw the relationship between the state and the Commonwealth with fellow countries, but never at the local level. And now to see that we are having that interaction with cities and with nations across the world shows that Richmond has matured, that we are more cosmopolitan because of the diversity of our population, but also the fact that we have institutions who work in this arena on a regular basis, whether it's University of Richmond and how diverse your student population is, VCU and the fact that they have campuses in other continents as well. And when I think about the fact that we have become a magnet for investment, yes, we've become a magnet for domestic investment, but also we've become also a magnet for foreign investment as well. And why not, right? Richmond is within a day's drive of half of the country's population. You can invest here and make a return on your investment as well. So there's a lot of different reasons why we've become this engagement, I think, is going to be special for the city, special for the region. And I talk about the city specifically, but this is a regional approach, right? It's good to be, I'm glad that I'm on the radar of the State Department, the city is, but when you think about this, it has to be 1.3 million people that serve this region. That's why the Chamber is here today, Chamber RVA is here, because they know that, yes, this is Richmond, we're 230,000 people, but this is more about the region. We're attracting investment from all across the world, all across the country, in Henrico, Chesterfield, and Richmond, and beyond.
So how do you see your office collaborating with Ambassador Hachin?
Well, you know, for us, it comes down to capacity. We are obviously focused on the day-to-day work of the city, whether it's infrastructure, invested in public education, you know, all the different issues that I know a lot of our residents care about. So do we have the built-in capacity to handle these sort of foreign relations? I'll tell you today, no, we don't. And that's where I think where the State Department plays an important role to help us build out that capacity, but also they can be used as a vehicle to strengthen the relationships that we already have due to our sister city relationships, or how do we expand upon those relationships, whether for business opportunities, business investments moving forward.
Terrific. President Ben Yehuda, thank you for making the trip down to Richmond. For those of you who may not be aware, the Truman Project recently released a comprehensive report about the importance of subnational diplomacy. And so maybe you could just give us a few top line conclusions.
Happy to. Yeah, well, thanks so much for having us. I'm delighted to be back in a university setting, especially when I don't have to grade papers. So it really feels like the best possible dynamic. No offense to the students here. Truman Center really felt like increasingly we were having these conversations at the local level and overseas, where maybe it's a combination of climate, pandemic health, cyber, so many issues where folks at one and the same time said, how do you do it better? And what can we learn from you? And also, where are you? I have questions. And who do I talk to about this? And so Nina and I have conspired for great things for a number of years. And we drew her in her office through then, you know, through Mayor Garcetti's shop, where she was deputy mayor. As co-chair of our effort, we drew in the mayor of the city of Atlanta, Andre Dickens, the secretary of state of Michigan, Jocelyn Benson. We have senator, we have a member of Congress. We wanted to hit at all of these levels of government, and then also brought in over 30 experts internationally, from Hungary to Atlanta to the West Coast, you name it, to bring in all of these various perspectives to answer a couple of questions about what is at stake? What is at stake if we don't engage? What are we leaving on the table? How much talent, how much opportunity, how much partnership is out there? And also thinking about what is the kind of defensive component? How do we think about cyber attacks and authoritarianism and misinformation? These are problems that are not confined to any one city. And so we felt like now was the time to really connect our national government with an eye, the State Department externally, also to all of the richness that American cities have to offer, both from the perspective of deepening that learning, deepening those shared exchanges. As we talked earlier today, you talk to your colleagues all the time, your counterparts in other cities. Folks face a lot of the same challenges. The same is true of other nations around the world at the city level. And so what this report really seeks to do, and you can take a look at it at trumancenter.org, is to leverage best practices, who's really doing this well, support the creation of this office, and offer some thoughts for how they can really dig in and get this work started. Because as you had suggested, I think there's really a palpable interest to do this work. And in many ways, I think mayors and governors have been saying, where are you? So it's exciting to be in this place and to have Nina in this role. There's really nobody better.
So are there tools and resources for cities and communities on the Truman website? I mean, are there?
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, we welcome you to check it out. We have a series of handbooks and instructional videos, definitional videos. Mm-hmm. What is city diplomacy? What does it mean to me at a citizen level, at a leader level? And we'll also be supporting efforts to start to pull together resources. Right now, there isn't a single repository of what various cities are doing. Oftentimes, it means running into a counterpart at a conference and saying, how are you thinking about affordable housing? Or, I had a delegation visit me from Shanghai. What do you talk about when you talk to each other? That doesn't exist in a central location, and that knowledge sharing is so important. You think about the department going overseas and engaging with their counterparts. Imagine bringing an army of experienced practitioners, because that's what our mayors and governors are. And so bringing that talent and making those connections are the kinds of tools that we'll be really focused on creating through this effort.
Thank you. Ambassador Hachigian, what are you mentioned there's a lot out there, and so you need to set priorities. What are your initial priorities, and what is the kind of impact you hope to have with them?
Yeah. So, you know, Mayor Stoney referred to the capacity issue, and that's a challenge for every city. And so we want to be helpful in finding creative ways to give cities and states when they need it that capacity. So that could be in the form of we hope one day an actual Foreign Service officer who could be detailed. That used to happen in the State Department, and we hope to revive that tradition. But short of that, you know, there are retired ambassadors. There's one right here who live in cities, and retired Foreign Service officers. There's World Affairs Council networks. There's a lot of potential resources that, and universities, of course. Who with a little encouragement might be willing to play that kind of advisor role for mayors and governors. So that's one piece. The climate crisis is always front of mind, and it's cities that actually produce a lot of the greenhouse gases when you look across the entire world. So there are networks like the C40, which is for really big cities. It's a global network that are all competing to kind of reduce their greenhouse gases the fastest. But at the State Department, we have programs that are connecting climate entrepreneurs and are offering the Smart Cities Business Innovation Fund, which will also help to foster entrepreneurial solutions. And then finally, I would say that the renewal of democracy is another priority. We've seen, this kind of creeping authoritarianism around the globe. And Mayor Stoney was actually saying earlier that about some donations that the city has given to Ukraine. And I know other cities around the country have done that too. But had we, had this office, we might have been able to make that whole effort a little bit easier, and for cities to do that. We know as well that the People's Republic of China has a very broad subnational program all over the place, including in this country and everywhere else. But we want to be out there, showing the benefits of democracy, be here for any questions that a local leader might have about an approach they're getting from from China, and we can discuss the many pros and the possible cons of that kind of a relationship. I want to be careful to note in this conversation that our competitive relationship is with China, not with the people of China, and that there is it's completely unacceptable for there to be any, violence or hatred against Asian Americans, which is rising, unfortunately, in this country.
Thank you. How do cities, communities, states connect with you?
It's pretty easy. There is a website and an email address. It's subnational@state.gov. And that's the easiest way so far. In the future, there'll probably be other ways, but that's the easiest way. I forgot to say one thing about democracy, which I would like to mention, which is there is a global declaration of mayors on democracy that any mayor can sign. And I think it has, I can't actually remember, but around 100, I think, signatories worldwide now. And so that's another thing that a mayor can do is just sign up to these very, for the United States, very straightforward principles. But there are many places around the world where mayors are living in kind of illiberal nations and are trying to hold on to democracy. So this is really a way of standing with them and showing them that, that other mayors are thinking about them and supporting them.
Great, thank you. Mayor Stoney, what do you think the priorities are for the city in terms of international engagement, and what do you hope to achieve with them?
Well, first I think they center around economics, right? I think about the economic benefit from the relationship we can have with the State Department that could lead to investment here locally that will create jobs for our people. I mean, right now, nationally, there is two jobs for every one person in the workforce. That's a good thing. That's not going to be the case forever. And so we have to be in the business of attracting more foreign investment. I think when you think about Richmond and its competitive position with other cities, whether in the Mid-Atlantic or the South, you look no further than Raleigh to our south, and they are far and ahead when it comes to when it comes to foreign investment. And if we want to be a competitive city, we have to be open to foreign investment. We also have to be very inclusive as well of those from different walks of life, different backgrounds, different religions. That's all necessary as well, because businesses want to set up in places that are inclusive, that are welcoming, where people feel like they belong. Mm-hmm. And I know the University of Richmond does a great job in sending that message. Additionally, I think that we could benefit from a relationship when it comes to tackling some of the issues that are not just experienced here in the States, but experienced across the world. And that's particularly the issue of climate change. Mm-hmm. No, this is not Norfolk, Virginia. No, this is not New Orleans, Louisiana. However, we do have our challenges when it comes to extreme weather events here in the city, and whether or not our infrastructure is up to par to handle some of the extreme weather that's going to be coming our way for years and years to come. And we know that there are countries in Europe and other continents who are tackling this issue and are being a whole lot more urgent and faster, particularly from the federal level when it comes to this. So we would love to see what's going on in other cities. Lastly, I will say, culturally, I think that's a major priority for us. As Richmond becomes a more cosmopolitan city where you can walk down Broad Street or Main Street and hear different languages being spoken, that's the sort of city that's going to attract the competitive talent necessary to drive our economy. And so we want to continue to attract those artists and artisans who want to set up shop here, or at least bring their pieces of work here to show a community that we're connected globally. Mm-hmm. We have to think globally, and we have to act globally. And I think that keeps us competitive with all the other cities in the Mid-Atlantic and the Southeast.
Mm-hmm. That's great, thank you. President Benyehuda, what's next on your agenda for furthering subnational diplomacy and work? What do you think is the next phase in order to help our officials in this area?
Sure. Well, I don't know if you can hear like the engines revving, but we have a lot of energy behind what I really think is a movement to connect all of the innovation and talent and agility that exists at the local level in furtherance of our global engagement. So much of what makes America strong is not centered in Washington, it's not centered just in New York, it is all across this country. But too often, we don't bring all of that talent to the table. Mm-hmm. So we're so excited to support your office, to connect localities, to serve as a connector and a bridge builder for those who are excited about the possibility. Truman has 16 chapters all around the country. And I'll tell you, when we talk to our chapter in Detroit about manufacturing, it is a very different conversation than the one that we have with our chapter in San Francisco, right? And that's part of the beauty of it. We want to talk about subnational diplomacy. You know, there are pickup trucks sitting on plant floors in Michigan that have to be moved one at a time because of the chip shortage. So you put the chip in the car, you drive it off the assembly line, you take the chip out, and you go back in. Mm. And there are thousands of cars sitting, ready for export, ready for sale, and we're stuck. Mm. So I think as consumers, we felt that supply chain shortage on a personal level in lots of ways. But our nation also is experiencing big questions around resiliency and economic growth and our ability to compete in this really dynamic and challenging environment. Being able to connect the dots with those conversations, whether it's from Detroit to San Francisco or to Richmond, and think about the intersection of those challenges and bring those perspectives together, that only strengthens us. You talked a little bit about building those additional ties, right? You think about how strong a rope is when it has a single strand. That's national government. If we add a strand for every city, for every capital and every state, think about how strong that rope becomes. Who led the United States on the Paris Agreement after the United States as a government withdrew? Cities and states did. Cities and states met and in some cases exceeded national targets under the Paris Climate Agreement. That is the kind of policy resiliency that we need to seed around this country to continue to be competitive and deliver real results for the American people.
So that's kind of talking about states and cities. You're an NGO, you're involved. What's the advice for other NGOs that want to hook up to get involved in all this?
Well, Truman's a big tent. We love to partner. You know where to find us, trumancenter.org or trumanproject.org. We have, as I mentioned, our chapters all around the country. If there's a major city, turns out likely that there's going to be a Truman chapter near you. So we welcome folks to reach out. We're excited to dig in at a local level, whether it's supporting city's council or mayors or governors, as the case may be. There are lots of ways to get engaged, and it takes all of us. We focus on this from a foreign policy and national security lens because we believe that all of these decision makers are increasingly frontline national security decision makers in a way that wasn't always the case. But there are other areas where we have NGO colleagues working on sustainability, green energy, green climate jobs, a whole range of matters. A lot of this knowledge really needs to be shared, and we look forward to growing those who are thinking about ways to make those connections around the country.
That's terrific. So we're going to turn to our audience. If you have questions, please come up to a mic. I'd love to hear your questions. I know the panelists would. And I'm going to just ask the ambassador a question while you are all thinking of queuing up. This is about audience members, those streaming live, our students here. How can we get involved?
Yeah, so I would say, use that email address, subnational@state.gov. The State Department has all kinds of opportunities for internships, for virtual internships, various paid internships for students. And I would say for universities, send us your ideas. Like we don't have all the answers, and we would love to hear from you and from cities and states as well. Like we want to be of service, and this is brand new, so it's a good time to shape it. And we have, for example, a city summit for the Americas coming up in Denver in April. And we're going to be convening American mayors with all the mayors of the hemisphere, so from Latin America, Central America, Canada, to get together to compare notes on solving challenges for economic linkages. We'll have a youth component to it. So, and if anyone is interested in that, we certainly need help and ideas on that as well. So, there will be more concrete opportunities as we move along. For now, ideas would be great.
Yeah. So, just one for you, which is some type of curricular initiative from the State Department on globalization. Like, how do you encourage the development of curricula and co-curricular projects that would educate people on this, develop skills that can then become best models that institutions around the country can adapt?
Great idea. Yeah. Thank you.
So, question, please.
You've both done a lot of work to further the role of women in the world, and I'm wondering how that fits into subnational diplomacy.
That's a really good question. So I think it's true that I've actually started helped to start a number of different initiatives that try to create equity for women leaders and for women of color in particular. So we do have, as part of as one of the city networks that we'll be working with, one that I helped to start in Los Angeles. It's called Change. It's the City Hub and Network for Gender Equity. It's citieschange.org. You can find out their material. So it turns out that mayors have a lot of authority, which is something I didn't really think about until I worked for a city, over the lives of women in terms of educational opportunities, of symbolic or raising leaders that are women to be role models, how you respond to domestic violence cases, how the police respond, or rape cases, how you design your transportation system is different if you're thinking about women versus men. So you know, that will be one of the networks that we work with, and any, you know, cities that want to learn more about that will be encouraging that, and likely to be a feature at the City Summit for the Americas as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I would just add quickly that women are heads of household in majority countries around the world. Women are making massive economic decisions every day that determine the outcomes of countries. Women are also waging peace, and when women are involved in peacekeeping conversations, we know that that peace is more durable and sustainable. So part of this also, though, means that representation is really important. So we have a lot to learn in this country from other nations who have much higher levels of senior women in government. State Department is still about 30% senior women. That is not the case in other countries around the world. So the data is there, the reality is not. And so we have a lot to learn from countries all around the world to bring equity in through a number of different lenses. And I think this is one additional avenue towards that.
Thank you.
Please.
So I was fortunate enough to be a youth ambassador through one of the programs that the State Department actually funds, which is the Congress Bundestag Youth Exchange. However, you know, considering the discussion around subnational diplomacy, one thing that we always really had to work on as participants was advocating for funding, because that was just a main component of our job, was that we didn't receive a lot of the funding that we needed. So considering the importance of subnational diplomacy, what are the steps being taken to fund these important programs among youth, and also how can we help participate and help encourage that funding?
Yeah, well, I think that's a really important point, and not one that I had focused on. I mean, in general, I have had great experiences with youth councils. We had a couple in Los Angeles. One was just a general youth council to advise the mayor, and then we had another one on gun violence, and we had another one on climate change. And always those voices are so important in a policy conversation. But I will think about the funding question, because that's really an important one. And I would be shocked if there were not sources of funding somewhere in the State Department that you could apply for, but I don't know what they are off the top of my head. So let me take that back and think about it. It's a good, thank you for raising it.
Thank you.
Please.
Do you want to go first? You were here first.
No, it's fine.
Okay.
So diplomatic.
So my question's kind of for everyone, but so from what it sounds like a lot of these opportunities come from the cities reaching out to your different departments and asking for these resources, or at least like some collaboration between. So, and from what it sounds like, these opportunities are what causes places like Richmond to become more and allows them to have these resources. It's the trickle-down effect. But how do you propose extending these opportunities to cities and communities who might not have the resources to address these? Because couldn't the downside of this kind of program be to increase the innovation gap between communities like Richmond, who are very innovative, with compared to communities like where I'm from, New Orleans, Louisiana, where we are still kind of struggling?
New Orleans actually has some great people working on international stuff in the city, for what it's worth. But I think that's a really important piece to keep in mind. And, you know, we're going into this wanting to help whoever is interested in, you know, in engaging more internationally, whether that's a big city, whether it's a small city, whether it's a town, whether it's a county. I was introduced the other day at an event by a mayor of a small town in Florida who has a big international horse arena. And so their international experience is all through horses, you know, coming and going from, I guess, around the world to go to his city. So it can happen anywhere, really. As long as the desire is there and the interest is there, and we're really happy to help. But it's important always to consider the equity. I think in terms of foreign direct investment, I've been thinking about it in terms of focusing on underserved communities. And similarly with the opportunities for young people, particularly those who wouldn't otherwise get an opportunity. So thank you for that. Yeah.
Thank you.
And anyone else who wants to? Yeah.
Oh, I was just, can I add that, you know, this is just, this happens at the local level sometimes because there are some residents who are always going to be in the camp of, nah, I think the city should be directing its energy towards filling my pothole, picking up the trash, working on homelessness, and you leave all that other stuff to the state or the federal government. So I would say if, you know, there are elected officials out there who are going to have to weigh and balance what do they want their engagement to look like. I think that as the leader of this city, that this is a cosmopolitan city that's looking for a bigger footprint beyond the 60 square miles here in the city of Richmond, or beyond what the regional footprint may be. We want to be able to compete with Charlotte and Atlanta and all these other, I would say, global metropolitan areas across the country. And in order to do that, you have to have sort of this engagement happening. And so my hope, and this is the one thing, this is my, I have to say this, Ambassador, when new programming like this begins, you, as a leader, you have to start thinking about, well, how long will this go for? What's the sustainability of this look like? Because I know in the federal world, there's an election every 4 years, and the priorities of the State Department change with every administration. And it's my hope that this is solidified for the long term, instead of it just being a project of the Biden administration. This should be the work of the State Department for years and years to come.
I couldn't agree with you more. And we are thinking about that. There actually is bipartisan legislation in Congress to make this, and that legislation has been around for 2 or 3 years to make this office permanent. Cool. So, yeah.
I would just offer that I really appreciate the question. I think it's a really, really important one. And one of our goals through Truman Center's work is to really make these resources accessible so that, you know, for smaller cities who, and many cities don't have a deputy, most cities don't have a deputy mayor.
No other city has a deputy mayor.
Even New York has
commissioner.
A commissioner, right. Yeah. So, and you think about what the city of Shanghai has more people focused on U.S. cities than all of the U.S. cities focused internationally combined.
Mm. Yeah, that's true.
When we talk about being late to the table, we are late to the table. So how do we get there faster? It's not just going to be by creating offices around the country, much as we would like to see that happen. It's also about sharing those lessons so people can take action now. So I appreciate the question, and I think it's something we really need to remain seized with.
Thank you so much.
So, something that you guys have been talking about is not just making this or, you know, moving through this and solidifying it as efficiently as possible, and, you know, not just being late to the table, but catching up, right? Mm-hmm. And something that also seems important to me is that solidification, making it bipartisan, stuff like that. And specifically, this is a question for Mayor Stoney. When you were talking about the three types of development in the city of Richmond, one of them was cultural, and it just like stuck out to me. It seemed interesting because I think a lot of these exchanges can happen at the sort of like the top level, if that makes sense, right? Between like diplomats and I was looking through the sister cities that Richmond has, and it's quite impressive. I mean, among them are many in Africa, and I was looking through the different exchange activities that Richmond has with its sister cities, and one stuck out to me, which was Saitama City, Japan, which is the cultural activities that annually, Japanese families come to the city of Richmond. It seemed very the word seems to be practical, right? Because I think it's important to note the people of the city itself, and I think fostering a sort of cultural consciousness of looking outwards, right? And so I guess the question is, right, Mayor Stoney, how do you plan on advertising this to the people and kind of, you know, fostering this outward thinking consciousness to not just vote for mayors who put all their funds in fixing the potholes of the city or stuff like that to actually, like, you know, move towards progress.
Well, I'm glad you stated it best that we have to be more conscious about our global relationship than we have in the past. Mm-hmm. And for me, obviously, this is always a, that's why I said what I said earlier, because there's always a, there's always going to be a little fight about how you go about spending the funds of the taxpayers. And a lot of times taxpayers want you to just spend the funds on the potholes in the roads. However, I think if we can show the benefit, and you've been able to identify the fact there are some cultural, true cultural, and I think economic benefits to these relationships. And I think maybe the city, as a city, we have to do a better job in highlighting the benefits for our people. I think a lot of times folks just, they see this as extracurricular. Mm-hmm. And I like to see this is a necessary, right? This is, if we want to be competitive, it's necessary that we have these exchanges with our sister cities. But just beyond that, just make ourselves more welcoming for investment, but also those exchanges as well.
Thank you.
So it's going to take, so to simplify that, it's going to take a little money.
Right.
It's going to take some investment, because you just, by putting it on social media, doesn't get the word out, the fact that we have sister cities. Because you're going to have the folks who want to volunteer and also invest in making these relationships what they are.
Mm-hmm. Just to add to that, I was reading this article in a newspaper that ranked American cities on how accepting they are, or how good they are for foreign business. And one of the metrics was that welcoming piece. Mm-hmm. And that feeling like you belong, and your culture isn't necessarily represented, but you feel like you can get along with people, and the city wants you to be there.
That's right.
So that was one of the metrics, in addition to all kinds of other stuff. But it is important.
It's significant, yeah. And Ambassador, we spoke about this earlier, about how the ease of travel as well. Mm-hmm. Something I know that, right, we've talked about in the past as well, how easy can you travel to Richmond, mm-hmm. or from Richmond to other places? And I see a lot of heads nodding in the audience, because everybody's like, Mayor, I got to connect everywhere I go. That's not just on me, it's just a regional thing. But but we have to obviously improve in that realm as well, on how we get to not just other places domestically, but how do we get internationally, get outside of the city, outside of the country as well.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So hi, my name is Brady Lang. I'm a junior here at Richmond. I'm also from Midlothian, so local. My question is sort of related to that one, but concerning cosmopolitan and how Richmond is moving towards that, when I talk to many of my friends, something we look at Richmond as, and what we want it to be more, is safer. And we look at the news, you see homicides are going up. 2021 last year was a record year for in decades. We haven't had that in years. So going towards the future, how is being more cosmopolitan going to help Richmond to be a safer place, one that really is better at education? We just had a report, I think it was a couple weeks ago, where test scores are just nationally ranked like in failing schools. And so how is this going to help the people of Richmond in the parts which aren't as affluent, such as in the West End, as other parts? So how is that going to help them?
I guess that was directed to me.
If you guys want to speak on, like, for other cities as well, how would being more cosmopolitan help them to get to their long-term goals?
Well, I will say first that, when I look at crime and public safety, that is not just an issue that is being experienced by the city of Richmond, but a lot of urban locales all across the country are seeing a spike in crime, and not just urban locales, rural areas. I think recently a study came out that the per capita crime rate in Oklahoma has gone up exponentially since the 2020 pandemic. Nonetheless, we know that people want to invest and live in places that are safe. And I will tell you this, if we get more foreign investment, right, if we expand our relationships outside of just the city, that reach into other countries that want to invest here and invest in the workforce here as well, that creates opportunity. And I believe, as the leader of the city, that we have to be in the opportunity business. We have to be in the hope business, and we have to be in the dream business. If you give individuals opportunity, right? Their hands are not idle, right?
Yes.
And they have the ability to actually buy a home or build generational wealth for themselves that allows for their children to live in safer communities. And it gives them hope that they can actually achieve their God-given dreams. That's what our focus has to, we have to remain focused on that. We have to be in the opportunity business. When I think about foreign relationships, I think about the potential for more opportunities.
Thank you.
Yeah, the only other thing I would say is that, you know, when cities in other countries, bringing them to the table to discuss public safety is another interesting like angle to this. Like the people do public safety around the world in very different ways. And so you can also, you know, just learn practical things about how other countries, how other cities are policing and that we could learn from. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Mayor Stoney, as a resident and taxpayer of the city of Richmond, I appreciate your comments about the limited capacity of the city's resources and the importance of stewarding them. And I can understand why cities like the size of LA, which are, you know, bigger than many countries, would invest in these resources and put effort into this. And I also understand that things like sister cities programs and foreign direct investment, these are things that our Chamber of Commerce tends to be very concerned with. I guess what I'm looking for here, and maybe this is a question for you, President Ben Yehuda, is what are good examples of cities that would be the size of the city of Richmond that are doing this well? And can you note any specific value added that they get from this kind of activity?
Well, one of the things that we really want to do through this work, which we're expanding over the next couple of years, is to really draw in more and more of those examples. You know, we know only just, I think, the kind of treetops of what's out there, and we want to connect folks on that. I've heard, I mean, the mayor of Atlanta speaks really eloquently about the nature of growth in Atlanta over the last 10 years being directly attributed to economic development. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, Richmond has a wealth of knowledge from its university base, from its health system, from its geographic proximity to broader labor markets and drawing in talent. You know, there's no reason why with additional that care and feeding and welcoming nature that makes countries, so you can see where I spend most of my time, cities more attractive to that investment, that you can be on that path to growth. But I think it's an excellent question, and oftentimes, you know, I'd really be interested in your perspective, Mayor, when you talk to your counterparts, what are similarly sized cities doing that there are sources of learning for you and also where you can take that? Because you're right, LA is a multiple many times over of the size of city of Richmond, but there's also a lot of agility and flexibility that comes from being smaller.
Yeah, I will add that, you know, when we do lack the capacity, this is where I think cities have to lean into their cross-sector partnerships, mm-hmm. right? Partnering with the private sector, the nonprofit world as well, to create the sort of create the response. And there are cities across this country who are doing exactly that, that are leaning on those investments from their business community, but also using their nonprofit community as well as the center, I guess, to sort of house some of this activity. And so that's something we're interested in. We, as we look at our sister city relationships, we sort of have some sort of a model that's similar, very similar to that, where we have individuals who are appointed to the private citizens, who are appointed to the Sister City Commission. We have a nonprofit that sort of is the center for the fiscal agent, I guess you can say, in the government. And then we have employees to sort of staff that sort of operation. However, if we want to take it to the next level, we're going to need more investment on that front. So I think it's possible. I know that cities across the country are doing it that are our size. I mean, New Orleans, believe it or not, is not too much bigger than Richmond these days. Mm. I mean, it's around 400,000, I think. We're 230,000. But as I stated earlier, I think we have to tackle this as a region as well. Mm-hmm. Because there's so much that we do regionally here, this is something that should be on the regional agenda. Mm.
Thank you all. I've enjoyed the panel quite a bit.
Well, thank you, everyone, for the great questions today. Unfortunately, we're out of time. I'm sorry about that.
We'll come find you.
Yeah. Can we do it after, if that's okay? And I want to thank both the audience here and the audience online. And I particularly want to thank our panelists for a terrific job. Can you join me in thanking our panelists? Very much appreciate you being with us today here at the University of Richmond. We have a reception that will begin immediately in the area just the Lou Mulcher Commons just outside this room. We hope you all can join us. Thank you for taking the time to be with us today.
Thank you.